care of you. I want you to turn your Bibles to Luke 22. Verse 14. And when the hour was come, he sat down, and the 12 apostles with him. And he said unto them, "With desire have I desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say unto you, I will not any more eat thereof until it be fulfilled in the kingdom of God." And he took the cup and gave thanks and said, "Take this and divide it among yourselves. For I say unto you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God shall come." And he took the bread and he gave thanks and he brake it and gave it unto them, saying, "This is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." Likewise also the cup after the supper, saying, "The cup is of the New Testament in my blood which is shed for you. But behold, the hand of him that betrayeth me is with me on the table. And truly the Son of Man goeth, and it was determined, but woe unto him and to that man by whom he is betrayed." And they began to inquire among themselves which of them it should do this thing. And there was also strife among them what should be accounted the greatest. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word here this morning. We thank you for your voice speaking, ministering to our hearts. We just thank you for your word that brings us change. In Jesus' name, amen. We can see, obviously, of a passage of Scripture that we want to be careful of, that we think that we know or we've read so many times. But just like God's Word, there's always something to receive from it. One thing about when it comes into this month of Thanksgiving, it's this place of giving thanks. And anytime we attribute giving something, we feel like, in our minds, we think or we limit it to, that if I'm giving something, it's because I have more of, I have extra, that I have to give from. And that's not always the case, is it? When it comes to giving, there are plenty of times we've got those testimonies. Maybe we gave when we didn't have extra. Maybe we gave. Have you ever given when you didn't have any? I know that there was a testimony of one that they wanted to give more, so they actually got a second job to give more. You know, some people are always waiting for the ship to come in, or when this happens, then I'll give more. But it's talking about putting some action to your faith by going out and even doing that. I know there are those that maybe when they didn't have something to give, they've come and they've given of their time. They see Pastor Sandy with their passion for a clean house. And, you know, Jesus said, "My house shall be a house of prayer." He turned up tables. Pastor Sandy's turned up tables too for different reasons. And my house, she says, shall be clean. And she has right to on some days that you can see. She keeps this place clean. But some have come just to give of their time, and even from cleaning to just volunteering in certain ways. At times because maybe they didn't have something they wanted to give, and so they gave of their time. There's so many ways of giving, really. And as we get ready to give here this morning, I know we have declarations that we declare over our seed on a regular basis. But one thing about it is God is always in this, has a way of surprising us. When we think giving has to be something out of surplus or even something to give, on what begins to happen, we can see from Scripture, from Old Testament to New Testament, of times and instances and moments where when they were able to give when they didn't have it to really even give. Didn't have anything left in a famine, but began to gather some jars. It's giving of overflow beginning to happen, not out of abundance, but actually at a place when sometimes you don't see like it seems to be enough. God is in the business of taking our not enough and transforming it into more than enough, isn't he? And so we're going to take our seed here, and some are giving out of abundance, some are giving out of faith, some are giving from the hearts, all from the hearts, but just tonight, this morning, I just want you to grab that seed in your hand as we declare, as we receive today's offering. We are believing the Lord for jobs and better jobs, raises and bonuses, benefits, sales and commissions, favorable settlements, estates and inheritance, interest and income, rebates and returns, checks in the mail, gifts and surprises, finding money, debts paid off, expenses decrease, and blessing an increase. And we thank you, Lord, for meeting all of our financial needs, that we may have more than enough to give into the kingdom of God and promote the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you, ushers. As they're receiving of the tithes and offerings, when it comes to giving, our thoughts on what it is to give. As we see Jesus sit at this table, I don't know your testimony on an experience, someone that's betrayed you in life. Jesus is sitting here at this table amongst those who are closest to him in his ministry, those that he would definitely consider friends. And as he begins to describe, there is one here that's going to betray me, I find it interesting that it wasn't actually, it was completely different. They didn't know who Jesus was talking about. They couldn't tell. They began to wonder, is it me? Lord, please, it can't be me. Matter of fact, we even know of an instance where Peter is saying, look, even if everybody else leaves you, Jesus, I am not going to leave you. And as much as his great intentions were, Jesus begins to give him a word of knowledge, word of wisdom about the time when he was going to be leaving him, not just once or denying him, but three times in one evening. And yet they're all surrounded in this, and you know, I don't know about you. If you've ever got a chance to sit and eat dinner with a minister, those are some of my favorite moments. I love to sit as we've been blessed with some amazing generals that have come here. That's that time where I love to ask questions, where I love to hear. It's away from a church service. It's beyond the service. And I want to hear some personal stuff. If you've ever had those chances, when we have our conferences, I try making available Q&A. So that way people can ask the questions like that if you've never had a chance. So can you imagine what it was like eating bread with Jesus, what that must have been like? Could you imagine what it must have been like with your opportunity to sit there and ask him? We heard a lot of great questions through the New Testament, and they're asking and trying to find out from Jesus, why is it that when we prayed it didn't work? Have you ever asked that one before? Hey, Jesus, would you teach us how to pray? Because we really want to know how to pray like you pray. Anybody ever asked that one before? And they're surrounding by this table, and now what's coming forth from the Messiah's mouth is somebody here who's been walking with me for 3.5 years, our blood and our sweat and our tears is going to betray me. And nobody knew who it was. Then, to break into the next conversation, it says that they begin to have the strife and contention over who was the greatest. So, here Jesus is eating, and he's trying to bring them into this new covenant that he's trying to describe, knowing that they won't quite understand it. That this bread that he is symbolizing is for his body that was to be given. This cup is the cup of my blood that is for the remission of sins. And, you know, I don't know. Have you ever sat down with your kids trying to make a moment? I don't know, maybe Thanksgiving. How about being thankful? Have you ever tried to have a moment with your children? And we find Jesus trying to deal with communion and what it means and the importance of it. Going right over the head. They don't understand what's going on. And, you know, I really love this about Jesus because there's so many times I know I'm not getting it. I know I'm saying, God, this seems over my head. And I love his mercy and I love his grace because he's not like slamming his fist down on the table and saying, would you please shut up on who's the greatest? I'm trying to show you this communion. I know you're not quite grasping it because I'm talking about I'm getting ready to suffer and you're arguing with me that I'm not going to be able to suffer. I know I'm trying to talk to you about the blood that's going to be shed, this new covenant. This is going to be incredible. This is a new covenant being introduced into the earth. And they're fighting over who's the greatest. These were his closest. I know it's hard to believe Christians in ministry fighting over who's greater than the other, but just try to imagine with me, okay? Trying to fight over who's holier and who has the right to be more offended at the other. I know it's hard to grasp, but I want you to try grasp with me because Jesus is trying to describe this, and he's literally saying, even do this, right? And remembrance of me. Do this, please, in remembrance of me. We see them only moments after fighting over who's the greatest. Even though they don't get it, even though they don't understand what's going on, they're missing the moment as they're... Here you are having this holy moment, and they're bringing strife into the equation over who's the greatest, not even listening to what he's saying. He's saying, do this in remembrance of me. So often in our mindset of what we think we have to be thankful for, it's hard a lot of times because we have moments of pressure. We have the tight places of life. We have the stressful moments of life that we're saying, God, I'm trying to be thankful. I know it's the month of November and I'm supposed to be thankful, but it's a little hard right now. Sometimes life has positioned you at a place where it's hard for you to see something to be thankful for. Maybe you're so busy, so stressed out because of work, because you have one of those bosses. Maybe in regards to what it may be, you're having a hard, difficult time. Your children are causing the strife, and who knows what the case. We all have our own testimonies, right? Can I hear an amen? And so life could be like this, and you have a hard time. Well, I want you to picture, because a lot of times we think we have to be thankful or find something in our life in that moment to be thankful for. But I want to introduce to you that this is the type of moment Jesus is in right now, where he's facing the suffering that he's getting ready to go through. And just a few hours, what he's getting ready to enter into. His closest are fighting over the greatest, and one of them is going to betray him. And he's prophesying his betrayer. And it's in this moment that Jesus gives thanks. Come on, Gateway. It's in a moment when I don't see too much to be thankful for. In Jesus' eyes. It's in a moment that he took the cup and he gave thanks. It's a moment that he took the bread and he gave thanks. In the midst of strife and stress, in the midst of, I'm trying to tell you plainly, and you're not getting it. And he's speaking about something that's coming in the future that they were going to be able to step into, even though they couldn't comprehend it. This blood that you don't know about, that when the shepherd is struck, the sheep are going to scatter. It's the very blood that's going to bring this new covenant. And it's in this blood that your sins are forgiven. Your sins are wiped and washed clean. It's from far as the east is from the west. It's your sins that you don't have to battle with and struggle with. There is a way for you to enter into a relationship with God, and it's going to be through the shedding of this blood. And it's with this cup I give thanks. In a moment of my betrayer getting ready to betray me with a kiss, in a moment when you guys are fighting over what you think is holy and what you think is powerful, it's in this atmosphere that he gives thanks. And he's teaching us not just at this Last Supper, but 2,000 years ahead into time, that we can look in this moment and he's leading us how to walk through stressful lunches or dinners. Thanksgiving is on the way. You're going to have to, you get blessed to deal with family. Mothers-in-laws and fathers-in-laws and children and more children and more children. And Jesus shows us how to get through a moment. And he says, do this in remembrance of me. If you can't find something to be thankful for, you need to go back into the remembrance of where he's brought you from. You need to go back to the place where he pulled you out of the mud, where he took you out of darkness and into light. You need to go back to the places that are easily forgotten by life and by time and by stress. And he says, I want you to remember me. Remember the times when you're going through. There's going to be moments that are coming up that you're going to be hit so hard, you're going to be tempted to have amnesia. But I'm telling you, remember me. And he's saying something that's hard for them because they don't understand what he's saying. So he's saying, remember me and according to your future. There are some things you're going to need to remember that pull you into your future. To get through moments that you don't understand. Jesus is talking and it's going over your head. You are so far off the map as you're struggling and arguing over who's the greatest. And he's saying, remember me. Remember my body. Remember my blood. Remember this moment. Do this in remembrance of me. It's a precious communion that goes beyond tradition. It goes beyond what you're supposed to do on a regular basis out of routine. But it's a lifestyle that we are to live. To remember him, to getting into a place of our future. To remember what he's done for us, enabling us. Why? Because when you can remember what he's done, you can remember the writer of Hebrews 13:8 that says that Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And when you remember what he's done, it stirs this passion in you about that God can do it again. When you remember what he's done, you can remember that he can do it again in your life. He can restore hope to fallen dreams. He can bring healing to sick places of dreams, your heart or even your body. He can bring this healing and the miraculous right back. And the beauty is he can do it. He can let light shine out of darkness. He can take nothing and make abundance out of nothing. He can sit there and he can do whatever he wants to do in a way that would blow our mind. He's done it before. Help me out, Gateway. And he's going to do it again. Turn to your neighbor and tell him he's going to do it again. The power of remembering that he can do it again. And now he's telling you, he's saying, I myself am walking into my suffering with thanksgiving. I'm walking into my suffering with hope. What is the hope? Jesus is getting ready to be crucified. The hands that he was a part at creation are going to be the hands that are striking him, pulling his beard, and putting nails into his body. Those lips that he were a part of are those that are going to be spitting on him, cursing him. Why? Because he's loved them. He's walking and entering into suffering, and he's saying he's even doing it by hope. There is a hope of a new covenant. There is a hope of a blood that's going to be able to bring us and make everything right that's been wrong, that makes up the gap, that brings us into a grace, that makes up the difference of anything that's lacking. There is a hope that gets me through the suffering. And we know Psalms 100 speaks of how we even enter into his gates. We've got to even stand at the threshold, at the very entrance of his presence that we know we enter in through thanksgiving and through praise. And he's displaying to us the power of thanksgiving. I'm getting a little long, but in this thing that says gates, it's actually gates or an entrance way or a place of transition. If you find yourself in a season of your life that you're ready for some transition, You find yourself to get to that place, to enter into your new season in life. It's got to be at a place of thanksgiving. But I don't feel too thankful. It doesn't matter what you feel like. Maybe you don't see anything to be thankful for. Then you go back to what you remember for what He's done. And then you remember in the hope of what He's going to do. Now I stand at this place called thanksgiving. Now I stand here with an expectation, not of my circumstances, of what I see, but I'm expecting that the God that's done it before is going to do it again. And I can stand, now I offer into a place that maybe I don't feel too good at where I am, but thank God I'm not where I used to be. Thank God that He's brought me. And I know that He didn't bring me this far to leave me where I'm at. And so I stand at a place of expectation, facing a betrayer at my table, facing the enemy that doesn't seem like it's getting any better, but it's only getting more stressful when it's supposed to be a moment, my last supper, my explanation of what's going on, and strife and stress is rising. And it's in this moment He enters in. And we come to this place in our life to the transition through thanksgiving and through praise. And if you can't find something right now, then you go back to saying, God, I thank You for what You did. And now I have a hope and an expectation of what He's going to do in my life. Now I confuse the enemy because I should be depressed. I should have my head hung down low and my shoulders shrugged down. But now I'm standing at a gate. I got a different look in my eyes. I'm not looking and reflecting on my circumstances, but I'm looking at the author and the finisher of my faith. Now I got a different look in my eyes, and I know that I can enter through the gates of transition with thanksgiving and praise. The power of thanksgiving is not resting upon the abundance of what you have to give. You might be standing there with nothing to give. Have you ever felt like I have nothing left to give? You stand at that place saying, God, I give You my nothing that I have. Right now, I give You the stress that I have. And I say, God, I thank You that You promised that You'll never leave me nor forsake me. I thank You that You said that the God of peace shall crush the serpent's head by my heel. And I thank You, God of peace, for the one who brings peace and my strife. And now I'm thanking, even when maybe I don't have a lot to be thankful for by the natural eye, but now I enter into a gate of transition and into a place of praise. I love it. I start with thanksgiving on one side of this entrance, and I step through, and I got some praise coming off my lips. I got some praise of what He's just done in my life. So everybody stands. Are you ready to enter through a gate of transition here this morning? As the pastors come, as the ushers are helping me here this morning, as they're passing out the communion, it's in this place that Jesus says, thank You. And it's in this thanksgiving, the breaking and the blessing that begins to happen. It's a place of thanksgiving that He steps into His suffering. It's a place of thanksgiving. And now you kind of wonder, Psalms 23, the psalmist says that You've prepared a table before me in the presence of my enemies. And Jesus is saying, with the betrayer on one side, strife and stress and suffering ahead, He's able to commune at a place called hope for the future. He's able to commune at a place about the new covenant that He's stepping into. The greatest thing that He's ever, that well, the purpose and why He was manifested to destroy the works of the enemy was getting ready to happen. And regardless of what it looked like or felt like, it was the greatest in what He was known, what He was created to manifest for in that moment. Yeah.
That's wonderful. What a rich word You gave us this morning. And if we take a hold of that word, and we can run with it, and we can act upon it. So, you know, the Bible says, for the joy that was set before Him,
yes,
He endured the cross. There's always joy set before us.
Yes.
And that's when we're at that table, our cup runs over.
Yes.
So let's lift the bread this morning. Father, we thank you for sending Jesus.
Yes.
We thank you for our merciful Savior, and we rejoice. And we thank you for this bread that represents his body. And we take it with joy today as we remember him. Let's take. And we lift the cup. Oh, we've got a cup of blessings. We got a cup of life this morning. We got a cup to rejoice, and we thank you for the cup. Let's take. Praise the Lord.
Now, can we give some thanks here this morning?
Oh, we thank you, Lord.
Yes.
We thank you,
Lord. Lord, as we follow after your example of a lifestyle of giving thanks in our life, we thank you for what you've done. We thank you for what you're doing, and we thank you for what you're going to do. Lord, we thank you for your word that shows us and tells us the end is that we win, that you are the one that has overcome, that you are the one that has brought and made a way of victory for each and every one of us, Lord. And we thank you, God, for what you're doing and what you're going to do in our life. And I thank you for the transition, Lord, of each and every one at Gateway, standing at the door, that this morning, Lord, we enter into this place of this season of our life with thanksgiving in our heart and praises on our lips. Come on, Gateway, let's lift up some praise. Come on.